Our economics correspondent, Paul Solman of WGBH Boston, has been looking at possible changes to the Social Security system. Tonight, he explores the question of whether some taxes could be raised to close the funding gap. Here's his report.
Earlier this year, we produced two stories on ways to close the projected Social Security funding gap, discussing them with young working students at a Boston community college. One way was to raise the retirement age. A second, to decrease benefits. We explained and then took votes. The proposals were rejected resoundingly. But there was another response.
I always enjoy Mr. Solman's features.
We got a fair number of viewer emails, including several like this one.
I hope you have another segment on the possibility of raising the cap at which we stop paying the tax. Sincerely, Genevieve LeBlanc, Eugene, Oregon.
Well, Ms. LeBlanc, since you went to the trouble of dramatically reenacting your email for us, the least we could do is look into your question. What about closing the funding shortfall by lifting the cap on income subject to Social Security taxes? And where better to ask about caps, we thought, than here? Commencement at Columbia University, where the typical graduate is likely to out-earn the income cap eventually, and graduating MBAs, according to last year's numbers, will start out-earning the cap right away, with an average starting salary of, get this, $143,682 a year. So we rounded up a group of MBAs and their parents for a mini-symposium with economist Stephen Zeldis, an expert on the financing of Social Security.
Right now, you pay 12.4% of earnings up to a cap of $90,000. That is split between employee and employer, but no taxes are collected on any earnings over $90,000 per person.
Now, the income cap on the payroll tax has risen, slowly, since 1982, indexed to average earnings. If earnings continue to rise, as in the past, the cap would rise. But not nearly enough to keep pace with projected Social Security benefits. Removing the cap entirely, thereby imposing a flat tax of 12.4% on all earnings, essentially a $100 billion a year tax increase on the wealthy, would more than completely close the funding gap. Even lifting the cap today to, say, $150,000 by using a different index would solve more than half the problem. But such calculations beg the question, why was there a cap in the first place? Well, Social Security was controversial when it was first created. President Roosevelt was careful to sell it as insurance, not welfare.
We can never insure 100% of the population against 100% of the hazards and vicissitudes of life, but we have tried to frame a law which will give some measure of protection to the average citizen and to his family against the loss of a job and against poverty-stricken old age.
But to some of the wealthy, this must have sounded like welfare, which their Social Security taxes would be paying for. To get them on board, an upper limit was placed on income subject to the Social Security tax.
Can I just ask you one quick question? You just put them on hold for just a second?
Okay.
To most people, though, at least on and below the sidewalks of New York, raising the income tax cap on Social Security seemed an obvious solution.
There shouldn't be a cap on it. Everyone should pay. Up as high as long as you're making the money, you should have to pay on it.
That makes a lot of sense.
Yes, of course. Because then it would help the lesser person.
I'll be in favor to lift it.
It's just a tiny little bit that richer people have to pay, and they won't feel it.
So if you made $500,000 a year, you think you wouldn't mind paying an extra $50,000, $60,000 for Social Security?
So that older people can be safe? Yes, I wouldn't mind.
Now, most of those we spoke with probably made less than $90,000 a year. Maybe class resentment was a factor here. And, of course, we were in New York, perhaps the bluest city in the bluest state. But a CNN USA Today Gallup poll in February found that two-thirds of Americans supported applying a Social Security tax on all income. And at Columbia, folks who will obviously be affected by a rise in the tax cap supported it almost as enthusiastically as those out on the street.
How many people are in favor of at least raising the cap to 150?
There was, however, an articulate holdout.
Certainly you can't tax just a tiny portion of the people to get yourselves out of this problem.
You can. You mean you shouldn't.
Correct. I'm not a part of that population right now, but...
But you hope to be.
I hope to be, yeah. Between now and 2045, I hope to have a few years where I'll be in that part of the population.
So it turns out, does one of our dozen or so interviews out on the street.
You want there to be a ceiling?
Yeah.
Because maybe you'll be making that kind of money, yes?
Almost.
An important reminder, then, from our man in the van and the freshly minted MBA in the back row, some people hope they are going to be wealthy and think the American dream involves not being penalized for it.
That's what makes the country great, is that we're all optimistic and that we think that we're going to reach that bracket whether we make it or not.
Everybody thinks they're that fellow up there, and it's a good thing they think that.
Everyone strives to be what that guy hopes he will be.
I feel a little bit less isolated now.
Reminiscent of President Roosevelt's worries about alienating the wealthy, there were two other arguments against raising the income cap without raising benefits commensurate with the higher taxes.
A, I think it's unfair, and B, I think it's going to create an incredible incentive for people to find a way to beat that system. What you are describing is a system where the person pays in and gets nothing back at the end on that level there. And I think that's where you lose people.
One of the reasons that even the Democrats are concerned about breaking the link between contributions and benefits is exactly this, that they're worried about losing the political base for Social Security.
Of course, fairness is in the eye of the beholder, as even people who'd probably be subject to the increased taxes were at pains to point out.
If one is a teacher, a fireman, or a police officer, all your income is going to be under the Social Security tax. But if you're a managing director at Goldman Sachs and so on, only a very, small percentage of your income is going to be under that tax.
So, his notion of fairness, in other words, is it's not fair that you make $1 million a year and you only pay Social Security taxes on 90,000 of it. Whereas if you make 50,000 a year, you're much closer to the bone and you're paying taxes on
everything you own, everything you make.
Moreover, high earners get a lot of their income not from pay, but from investments on which there's no payroll tax at all.
You don't have any Social Security on stocks, bonds, capital gains, etc. And a lot of the higher income individuals got a substantial tax break under this administration. So we have already given benefit to the people who are in the higher brackets.
But wait a minute. What if we raised the cap on payroll taxes and at the same time hiked Social Security benefits for high earners?
I'm fine with a benefit adjustment for people who are rich.
And you think that's fair?
Yes.
And you think that's not fair?
If you got benefits on the full 1.1 million, and if those benefits were, level with what other people get in their benefits, then it might be more acceptable.
But even if most of these folks, and most Americans, don't seem to buy the arguments against raising the cap, they may have to acknowledge one made by economist Zeldas, that taxing the rich could have unintended economic consequences, such as...
That people supply less labor. They work less because more of their labor income is being taxed. So there's a disincentive, perhaps, not to work as much.
And a disincentive for employers to hire workers making more than $90,000 a year, since employers pick up half of the payroll tax debt.
Yeah, absolutely. If you raise the cost to employ someone, then you're going to have fewer people who are going to be employed.
At the end of the day, there were, as usual here on the NewsHour, as in life, arguments on both sides of the debate over raising the cap on payroll taxes.
Start spreading the news.
But there's one final point to make, and it concerns the trend toward income inequality. That is, high earners have been reaping almost all the economic gains of recent years. Yet those gains haven't been shared with Social Security. As folks at the top earn more and more, Zeldas explained with slides, a growing share of total U.S. income is exempted from payroll taxes.
Okay, it's now 15%. It used to be 10%.
And this trend is exacerbating the looming shortfall in Social Security.
I've read people saying the fact that so much of the money is now exempt from Social Security taxes is part of the reason Social Security is underfunded. Is that true?
Yes. The greater the growth of wages of those under the Social Security earnings cap, the less of a problem we have moving forward for Social Security.
How to get more wages under the cap? Well, it turns out that raising the cap to $150,000 today would get us back to the historical average, taxing 90% of total U.S. wages instead of only 85%, as we do right now. It's a proposition our very non-random New York sample seemed to favor, but perhaps because it would raise taxes on the highest American income earners and give them an incentive to oppose or evade the Social Security system, it's a proposition that hasn't seemed to find much favor in the world of politics.